Good boy. What you're going to notice is sometimes he's allowed to just go do his thing, and other times he's with me. Try turning that. You sure you hear all right?
Yeah.
All right. Because I can't hear it, so I don't know what you're hearing. And I tend to mumble. When I halter my horse, I ask permission. So I'm going to ask him to put his head down and offer it to me. And I ask him to find it. I wait for him. And if he's busy or not interested or has something else on his mind, I'm going to know right away. Horses appreciate the same courtesies that we appreciate. Your horse will get defensive, just like you would if you were treated poorly. We develop the bad attitudes in them because they come to us trying their best. So your horse then becomes your mirror. And unfortunately, one of the hardest things about natural horsemanship is that mirror thing. My horse is my mirror. So if his attitude is unpleasing to you, then you really need to look at your attitude. Right? So what I'm going to talk about today, just understand that he's a professional, I am not. And I'm here today just to share with you what's been shared with me. And it doesn't mean that it's right. It doesn't mean what you're doing is wrong. It's just another way. My definition of natural horsemanship is understanding what's natural to the horse and getting that to work for me, not against me. Because you cannot take what's natural to a horse out of a horse. His instincts will always be there. And most of us understand that they are flight animals, they're prey animals. We are predators, the ultimate predator and the ultimate prey animal together. And it's no wonder we scare the bejesus out of them sometimes. And so one of the important things is to establish communication with your horse. And fortunately, they don't speak English, and so I feel like it's my job to learn to speak horse, or at least something that he can understand. Horses, I go around, I do a lot of trailer loading, difficult horses, and what I've discovered, I've done well over 200 horses now, and believe me, when I get them, everybody's tried everything on that horse, so they really aren't going to load. And that's where all your communication and trust comes together. So when I look at these horses, the first thing I usually see is fear. And that's something that we tend not to recognize in a horse, because we tend to think, well, he's doing this to me. You know, we don't understand that he's just trying to survive the best way he can. I've never met a horse that said no. I've never met a stubborn horse. I have met lots of horses that are afraid. I've met lots of horses that don't understand. And if I say to somebody, he doesn't know you want him to do this and so, oh yes he does, he did it before. But today he really doesn't. And we do things that the horse interprets totally differently than what we meant to say. So when we can learn to use smaller pieces and talk a little more impeccably to our horse, believe me, they will understand, and they never say no. You might find when I play with him at Liberty, he leaves me. That's because a lot of times he has more fun than I do. So he has his own ideas about things too, but he always tries to please me, and you'll see him leave and then come back. Especially if I stop looking at him and I talk to you, he'll go, hey, what about me? And he'll be right back. So he's convinced me that he has as much fun doing these things as I do. The bottom line is, we bring them into our life for a reason. You might want to do dressage, trail riding, hunting, jumping. It doesn't matter what you want to do. They are forced to live in our world. Think about that. It's our job, it's our responsibility to make it as easy for them as possible. And knowledge is what gives you the tools to do that for your horse. If there's ever a time when your horse said, I don't want you on me, and walked off from the mounting block, who walked away from you in the pasture, who did anything that made you feel like he doesn't love me, then you need to learn this stuff, because it's just a lack of communication. He does love you, but he just doesn't understand you. And horses, after a while, they either learn to learn or they learn to ignore, tolerate you. Nobody wants that in a relationship. So to some people, they're tools, and even if they're just tools, does anybody here know David and Karen O'Connor or know who they are? Okay. This is what they do with their horses. They teach them everything on the ground. The relationship is the most important thing to them, because they know they can't win without it. Because we need to get our idea to become the horse's idea. Then it's dependable. When we force the horse, the second he gets away, he's out of here. You just can't count on him. But when he does it because he wants to do it, he's dependable. And that's what we need for safety. I meet a lot of people who get their horse for their 50th birthday. There's none of those here, but there's a lot of them out there. They're afraid, they scare their horses, and they're learning for the first time at this age. So safety becomes a really big issue. We don't bounce like you kids do. Believe me. So it doesn't matter your age. Safety for you and your horse should be your priority. So the Pirelli program is the only reason I even mention that is because it's one of the few things out there that's actually a program. It starts with, this is how you tie your halter, this is how you lead your horse, this is how you do this, this is how you blah, blah, blah. Well, we all know those things, don't we? But let me tell you something. How you catch your horse, how you halter your horse, how you saddle your horse. When you begin your session with your horse, tells the horse how much you know and how much you care. So start there. Don't wait till you're in the saddle. Actually, the ground skills, this horse was very tough under saddle, still is, but I taught him everything on the ground first. So when I got into the saddle, because I'm not that good a rider, I'm not confident anymore, just the fact that I'm not young anymore and have a lot of aches and pains, so I'm not bounced where I can really help him under saddle, but by teaching him everything on the ground, I gave him confidence and understanding. So when I got into the saddle, I could do amazing things. I mean, they amazed me probably more than anybody else. So one of the first things you want the horse to do is not be afraid of things you don't want him to be afraid of. In the Pirelli program, they call it the friendly game. We use things like advance retreat. Instead of pushing him to the edge of the cliff and saying, come on, don't be afraid, you're not going to fall over. We do things more gradually. We let him come up and back and build their confidence. When I first got this horse, we use a stick as an extension of our hand. Maybe you could run or send somebody over to get my sticks. Anybody, but they're right over there by the time. I had him in my round pen, and when I put the string on that stick,
the gate.
In his mind, that was a whip. And his front feet went over the top of a 6-foot round pen.
The white sticks. They're right against the back of the trailer.
So this horse had tremendous fear, and I had never been dealt with something like this. So I think if you can take a horse like this and develop confidence, surely you can take a horse that doesn't have this kind of baggage and make them really confident and trusting. Both of them. One of the reasons we use a stiff stick instead of a whip, or like a dressage whip or something, it's not that there's anything wrong with that, but especially if you had a horse that was dangerous, This allows me to touch him with the same feel on him that I'm offering with my hand. If you had a whip, it would be flimsy on the end and you would not offer the same feel. The most important thing is that I don't have to get close to him. And believe me, 5 years ago you didn't want to be close to him. So what happened over time, as I learned how to build his confidence, I was able to do some pretty amazing things. Is he where I would love him to be for the rest of his life? Nowhere near. But for where he was, he's so dramatically improved. He wouldn't be with us today if I hadn't been able to do this. So things like saddling your horse, putting shoes on your horse, trimming your horse's feet, cleaning your horse's feet, bridling, anything that you do that you don't want your horse to react to would be what we call a friendly game in the Poorly program. The next thing would be what we call a porcupine game. This is anything that touches your horse. If I take my hand like this and put that much pressure on this horse, first I get vertical. See that? I pick up my energy, I get back. Which brings up another thing. Can't communicate without energy. Up and down. If you're tight and scared and you're pulling on both reins and your legs are wrapped around your horse and you got a buzz in your seat and you're saying, whoa, ain't happening. Your body has to say what you want to happen. So when I say to him, how about a little vertical? I have no energy in my body. I pick up my energy. I just hold my breath and there he goes. Now, wouldn't you like the horse nice and light like that? Now, forward. No energy. I'll pick up my energy. I want him to follow that feel wherever I put it, right? I want him to follow a feel on every part of his body. If I do this, I expect him to follow that feel. Can you see that? He's following his tail. I want to be able to lead him by every leg. Put that foot where I want it. Why would I want something like this? Any ideas? Put it there. What if he got caught in something? Giving to pressure. Horses are into pressure animals. And what that means is, if I scare him and pull, he's gonna pull back. The harder you pull, the harder he pulls. You cannot win. Horses are big and strong. Everything they do, you have to teach them. Trainers train the body. Teachers teach the mind. So we want to teach him to give to pressure. Anywhere in his body. If I get this horse so light, one of the things that we do in the Pirelli program is ride with a neck rope instead of a bridle. So if I get this horse so light, he'll move like this from that pressure. I can ride him like that. I don't need to pull on his face. So everywhere on his body, I want him to move to and from pressure and follow a feel. So what would that be? Here's a little exercise. This is kind of neat because you can get your horse used to things around his legs. This is a friendly game. Now I'm going to say, see me, but follow that feel. Don't come to me. Follow that feel. Follow that feel. Good. Now I put a little more feel on it. Nice, light. Any horse can be this light. So we want his entire body, wherever I put pressure, I'm asking him to put his head down, put his head up, put his head down, follow me, let me lead you by your ear, This is a horse you couldn't touch his head. Follow that feel wherever I put it. So, the next thing you'd want to do is move his airspace. Every person, every living thing has a personal bubble. Has anyone ever walked up to you and been too close? And you just want to go... Your bubble's met. His or hers was big. And it just got into your bubble and pushed on it. So we all have that personal space. Think about... Just imagine him with a big oval bubble around him. So I want to move every part of his body just by pressing that with energy. So if I push his butt, see it suck in? Did you see that when I put the pressure on it? He felt that. So where does his bubble begin? Well, here it begins right there. There it is. So if I break into that bubble and come back, break into that bubble and come back, break into that bubble and come back. I don't have to break into it. Now I want that to go. So, why would we want something like this? Bigger, bigger, bigger. Press the bubble, press the bubble. Press the bubble here. Press the bubble in the front. Press the bubble in the front. Press the bubble over here. Press the bubble here. Press it there. Press it here. So, guess what I could do? Let's just say he wasn't a Tennessee Walker that shivers along. Let's just say he was a quarter horse. And I wanted to do a spin. So what I could do, like when you want more out of your horse, you see how sensitive he is to my energy? You develop that. Or you develop dullness. Depends on what you do. Rewarding the slightest try is what gets lightness. Trying to make it happen is what gets dullness. So if you use your legs too much, your horse gets dull to that. And then you got to use more, and then you got to get spurs, and da 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 da. So, brace is created by us. If he were a quarter horse, and I said to him, let's just say this is my rein, and I'm pushing this horse in a spin, and he's going, but it's kind of slow. I'll give him a cue to speed it up, and I'll go, I won't hit him or go harder, I'll go, and now I'll push the air. I'll push the air, I'll push the air, I'll push the air. And he goes, I get it. You kiss, I speed up. Isn't that better than spurs? I have a horse at home that has a big lump here where somebody actually broke his rib with spurs. So, not necessary. I'm over here. So he needs to come to, and go away from, and come to, and go away from. Ooh, come on. Ooh. We call that slingshot. So, those first three games are the friendly game, the porcupine game, and the driving game. And that is what makes up the language that we speak. Everything else we do with a horse is a combination of those three things. So, if I can move every part of his body by touching, with my leg, with my hand, with my rein, whatever, and he's going to move away from it or follow that feel, imagine what I can do. And it's fun. Anyhow, come over here. I want to keep watching the time. Anybody?
4:40.
Ooh, we have 20 minutes, honey. All right, so... a lot of us lunge our horses to warm them up, right? One of the reasons, usually the reason, is to lunge them, is to prepare them to ride, correct? When I prepare him to ride, in my mind, you can never really prepare the body that way because you teach things that the horse doesn't need to know. Whenever I circle this horse on the ground, I want to be riding him. That's the way I look at it. So I'm always in the saddle in my position. And if I were, I'll just use this as an example, I'll take my crop, which is my big stick. So let's push him over here and let's back him over here. Let's back him over here. Now let's just say I'm walking along and I want to do a leg yield. So if I have my horse on a circle, so I want to be riding him. I might want to step that hind foot under. So I'm three tracking to get my arc. And then when I want the leg yield, I pick up his head and I ride him in a leg yield. So these are things that I would do on the ground. I would not run him in circles. I would say, stop your front, disengage your hind quarters, put some weight back, step your front end over. Let's try it the other way. Stop your front end, move your front end over. Put your weight back, and step over. So I would do things like that to get him ready to ride, because I want his mind, not his body. So I might as well do things that help him get light and supple under saddle. So those are the things that I would do. I'm going to show you a few things. In the Pirelli program, we talked about the next game is our yo-yo game. And that would be just what I showed you a minute ago, moving your horse forward and backwards in a straight line. And there's a lot, straightness, I think we all agree, is pretty important. So you can move him with a porcupine game, which would be this or this. You see the knots on his nose? I'm pushing him backwards with his nose. I'm bringing him forward with the back of his head behind his ears. Or I can use my energy like I showed you. The next game would be the circling game, and that's where I would do things like I just showed you. I might mix up the last two games, which are the squeeze game and the sideways game. I showed you a leg yield. We might want just sideways, not necessarily a leg yield. So I want him straight and maybe I want it this way. Step on your rope, honey. So that's moving to and from pressure. Right? What a good boy you are. And one of the most important games is what we call the squeeze game. And that's all about building confidence in your horse. And I need a couple of volunteers for this. Two. Pick two. Any two. Come on, kids.
Come on.
Two kids, right here.
There we go.
A bulldog and a... Can't read. Two bulldogs. Okay. If you could run over and get the... see those things sticking out of that barrel? Bring the barrel and the sticks right over here. I set this up because I assumed everybody was going to be sitting over there, so now I have to move a few things. So I need two more volunteers that can carry a barrel, or roll a barrel. There you go, two. There you go, good. Those two barrels over there, just roll them over here. Has anybody ever had a problem trail loading a horse? Come on, every hand, come on. I'm right in there with everybody, right? Do you know why? If you have trouble trailer loading your horse, don't trailer load your horse. Learn to communicate with your horse. He knows Because he's a prey animal, it is not a good idea to get into a metal cave on wheels. No matter how much brain you put in there. So it's all about teaching him and building his confidence. So, what I usually use is that platform over there. Can four of you pick that up? If it's too heavy, don't do it. And don't drop it on your toes, it's really heavy. What I do when I trail load a horse, when I go out to teach a horse to load, I do it in three sessions. The first thing I do is I do just what I showed you. I get communicating with that horse. I want him to move from pressure on all of his body.
Where do you want
them? Oh, wow, look at you. Just here, so you're really good. Because we're, don't drop it on your toes. Good, right there, perfect. What a crew, wow. You know what? Can you turn it that way? Careful, don't drop it on anybody. All right, that's good. Don't drop it. Don't think that's heavy?
No.
All right, so I need two people to stay in here, and I'll get you for something else. Can you wait right there? And then I'm going to use you for something else. All right, the first thing I would teach this horse, if I were to teach him the trailer load, would be what we call a squeeze game. So I need the two barrels. Can everybody see okay? That one right here, and the other one right next to it. No, standing up. Over here, hon. And maybe about 5 feet apart. Okay, and then just stand off to the side, a little closer. All right, squeeze game is just what it says. The first thing you would do is ask your horse to go between you and something else, to stop his front end and disengage his hind quarters. To go between you and something else, to stop his front end and disengage his hind quarters. Then move closer. Now it's a squeeze. So I'm trying to build his confidence in tight spaces. Okay? I would do that until he does it like that. Now I would take him over here to these barrels. And I'd say, Mackie, can you go between these barrels with confidence? Between the barrels, stop your front, disengage your butt, back yourself up a little, back up just a little. All right, go between them again. He rushed a little. When they rush, they feel the squeeze, so they get a little scared. So, stay with it until he's not afraid anymore. That was better. And always make him wait on the other side. That's better. Okay, let's see. Is that as wide as a trailer? Can you go to, ooh, good boy, that was pretty good. All right, so this isn't really enough to simulate a trailer loading, but it's a good starting point. So what I would do next is I might line up two more barrels on either side. If he won't go, widen it up. If he won't go, widen it up. So he goes. Get him going, start closing it up, and see how close you can get him to go with confidence. Go back to where it was good when he loses it. Build it again. So that's pretty good. So now we've got him squeezing between two tight places. So let's bring him over here. A lot of horses don't want to load because they don't like the way it moves and sounds. Move your butt. Stop your front. Back yourself up. Not yet. Not yet. Not yet. Put your front end over there. Put your butt over there. Go sideways over there. Now turn around and wait for orders from headquarters. All right, now. So, obviously, he does load now. But, so let's just say he didn't even want to do that. what would I do? I would back him up. This is why you need to have a light backup, because if you can't back your horse up, you can't do this. So you have to start at the beginning. You have to get all the body parts working. So this is advanced retreat. Up. Rest is here at the scary spot. If he has to back up, let him back up and back him right up. But bring him right back up again to the scary spot. Rest is always at the scary spot. Don't hold him there. He can go back and forth 100 times if he wants. Now, the real key to good trailer loading, put your butt over there, thank you, is to be able to move them forward and back within the space. You should never lock a horse in until you can, and of course in a trailer it would be going a little further. I have a couple come up. He knows that. That's okay, honey. You can come up. I have 2 rules about trailer loading. Never teach a horse to load with the front door open. Horses go out front doors, windows. Probably didn't know that, but they do. I have trailer loaded many horses that have exited out the people door and one that went out the drop-down window. They can do it, and they will do it. So, if they're convinced the only way out of that trailer is back, that's the key. So when I trailer load a horse, they will never turn around, and they will always back up, period. Everything's closed in the front. There are no options. So, why do horses get terrified in the trailer? It's because we put them in, trap them, and have never taught them how to get out. And that's what happens the first time. I heard people say, I don't understand it. He went right in the trailer. He was calm as a cucumber, and then it all fell apart. You never taught him how to get out. Do that outside the trailer. So that's why this advanced retreat works so good. If I had a ramp here, I would say, come up, halfway up the ramp, back up. Come up, and I would do this 100 times. He would be so like, let's do more. I'd say, when you can back up with confidence, then we can get in. Then when I finally let 3 feet in, 3 feet, honey, thank you, and back it up. 3 feet, 3 feet, and 3 feet, 3 feet. Get that foot off there. Oh, wait, right there. Thank you, and back it up. You don't have to do that. But you get the idea. If he can't back off, don't lock him in. He has to know there's a way out. You're a good fella. Know it. So, now we're building pieces of the puzzle. They're going to help you in wash stalls. It's going to help you. You can't imagine how your horse will change once he gets confident doing things like this. So now people say to me, well, he hates anything over his head. He smashed his head going out of the trailer, and now he just won't go in. Does that sound like anything anybody's ever heard? All right, especially with these big 17-hand warm gloves. He needs to be able to put his head down. So when I get a horse that does that, I will teach him to back out like this. Head down, good. And then, only then will he be allowed to back up. And he will go out every time like that. I won't start in the begin, in the middle. I'll start at the edge. Up the ramp, drop the head, back up. Up the ramp, drop the head, back up. So he just knows, if I drop my head, I can get out of here. So now your idea will become his idea. I know how to make her stop. I just drop my head and walk slow. And I do stop when he does that. So I reward the right behavior. So now, how do we get a horse confident? Let's try our limbo poles. See, let's do it over here. Everybody can see, I think. Right about here. So if you stand there and you stand there. Now, the only thing I want you to do is to keep it tight. Now, this is, you could pick it up in the air. These are so easy to make, and there's a lot of things you can make with plastic pipe. Just try to keep it level. So, and don't do it with a saddle on the horse. It's very exciting when they take the poles with them. Step up. So now I'm going to ask him to go under, disengage his hindquarters, back up. The reason that I keep asking him to disengage his hindquarters and back up, there's a thing called flight distance in every prey animal. And what that means, and this is natural horsemen, this is their explanation, that if you've ever watched National Geographic, you see the antelope galloping off and the lion's chasing them, and all of a sudden they stop and all turn around and look. He's still coming, they keep going. That's the second run. It's their flight distance. So what they say is that if they turn and they look and they see Uncle Jeb is visiting with the lion, they'll just begin eating grass. And people say, it's unbelievable, they're all eating grass and there's a lion over there with Uncle Jeb, you know, and they don't even care. Well, once they pass that flight line and they turn, they go from instinct to thinking. So lots of times you'll see the way to build a horse's confidence is to do 180-degree turns. And you'll see it all throughout the program in various ways. But that's the explanation for that, that they go from flight or from reaction to thinking. So when I build his confidence this way, all right, that's as low as it goes. Let's put it right down to the ground. Can you go through there now? Nope. You have to figure that one out. Figure it out. He says, it hooked on my halter. Well, back up, honey. Back up a little bit. Back up. I'm still stuck. Okay, now. There. Go ahead. Go ahead. Go ahead. Come on. All right. And he can't go much lower than that because it's rubbing on his back. So now what would we do with that? Let's take these over here. Bring that over there. And now we're going to squeeze him over something. You're going to use those again. Bring him over here. And not yet. First, let's see how he is squeezing with the barrels. All right. Can you go across this now? Yeah. Okay, one of you on one side, wait, and one on the other. And let's just see, just pull it tight. Well, you want him to be able to fit, so let's see if he can. Well, that was a little low. All right, honey, that was pretty good. Let's try it. This time, let's put your head a little bit lower. All right. Okay, now wait. Okay, lower it. That's good. All right, let's try something a little bit different. Now, so that's pretty good. That would help build his confidence. But how about this? Let's bring those barrels back and see if we can get him to jump a barrel. And then we'll try that too. One on either side. Come over here. Stand it up. And get ready with your poles. Can you jump this, Mackie? All right. Let's go the other way just in case. And by the way, if you like to jump your horses, teach them on the ground first. It is so much better. All right, one on one side, one on the other. See if he can jump through the hole. Make it tight. Lower. Wait. Yeah. A little bit lower. You know what you might do? Let's squeeze this. Put yours right close to the barrel. Come close to the barrel. Wait, Mac. Now just put it down like this and hold it like this, hold it down here, and then we're going to pick it up a little bit. I'll tell you when. Pick it up, keep it level, pick it up, a little bit more. Okay, that's good, right there. Let's see if he can jump through here.
Yay.
Anyway, I think he deserves a hand for that. Okay, you can just go put them anywhere, stick them in a barrel. So, things like that. I would play with barrel. You can get these, by the way, at car washes, and there's nothing dangerous in them. And they're pretty safe. So I would build his confidence through things like that, and also build his understanding of my direction. So now I can say to him, hey, let's go over here. Wait. Okay, now go. Wait. So he's, the only reason he listens to me like that is because I made it clear so he could understand. He's not a, well, yeah, he is kind of a special horse. No. But he's just a horse. But all horses can do this. And the reason that I'm so convinced that there isn't a horse that can't do it is that if you'd ever seen him 5 years ago and he can do it, anybody can do it. If I can do it, anybody can do it. So basically, that program, I always recommend it for people who are either new to horses or having problems with their horses, because it's everything is broken down into these little pieces that really help you understand. And it's not easy to change what you're doing. You don't really change what you're doing, you just do it in a different way. You do it putting the horse first. So once you learn to teach the horse instead of make the horse, your life will be so much easier. And it's getting kind of late, so I'm just going to close up shop here. But what I want to do is play with him a little bit and think about this while I play with him. I talked to you about desensitizing him, having him not react to things I don't want him to react to. I talked about touching him everywhere and teaching him to move to and from pressure, touching his airspace, having him. One of the things that I didn't mention that's probably the most important thing that you will get out of this in the safety aspect, has anybody ever been run over by a horse? Uh-oh. And do you know why that is? This is, again, getting back to natural horsemanship. In nature, the horse that's on the outside of the herd is the one that gets eaten. Okay? So instinctively, they go to the center of the herd. When you take your horse and you put a halter on him, you are now a herd of two. Somebody's in charge, either you or your horse. When your horse gets frightened, he will go to the center of the herd. That's why when you take a horse somewhere and he's scared, he's out of the trail and he's circling and he's winning, he's all over you. Because he has to get to the center of the herd. So if you have not created this bubble, he's on top of you and there's nothing you can do about it. It is not his fault. You need to create muscle memory in that horse. I was doing a demo with him down at High Hope Therapeutic Riding last year. And if you've ever been there, the barn is off the arena. And I was standing in front of the opening to where the stalls were, talking to somebody, plus you about maybe 30 feet from the doorway. And it was a big crash. He jumped. I was standing just like this. He leapt up and literally turned in the air. 5 years ago, I'd have been flat. I mean, flat. So he's just got, when you teach a horse something, you put a stimulus on, it goes to his brain, then to his feet. If you do it often enough, or if it's instinctive, or you create muscle memory, it goes from the stimulus to his feet. It doesn't go to his brain. That can be good or bad. Think about this. Did you ever drive your car, you're going down the road and you say, oh my God, did I stop at that stop sign? And you did, and you didn't think about it because you have a muscle memory. There are so many things that we do, and horses, because we do the same thing over and over again, they can just do it. And that is an example of that. But you must be consistent. Does your horse, when you're standing there, does he constantly just kind of creep up on you? And pretty soon you're talking to your neighbor like this, over his head, right? Oh, that's because you said, hey, come over here and hang by me. Now if you get scared, jump on me. You have to make up your mind. Either you're going to cuddle with him, or you're going to have that respect. And that's basically what it is. Does this mean that you can't go up to your horse and get into his face and say, give me a kiss, I just love you, or you're my favorite boy, and then step out? He will never touch me without asking. And I will reprimand him if he does. But I'll go in there and I'll love on him all I want. And it has to be that way because somebody has to be in charge. Okay? So creating these good habits, how you catch your horse, how you halter your horse, how you work around him, your politeness and firmness. Don't be a wimp. You have to get him to respond with respect without fear. You have to do whatever is necessary to make it happen. Another horse would, and you are now a herd of two, so take that responsibility. Learn how to do it properly, and you will be just amazed at what your horse can do. And I'm going to amaze you right now. I see this old lady and this beautiful horse. Are you distracted? Could you lower your head? Thank you. Could you give me a kiss? I taught him to kiss just by offering his forehead because he used to bite. I give him a face near those lips. Very big lips. Big lips. Big lips. So, I'm going to play a little music. Get my weapons.
Superstar, yes, that's what you are, you know it's true. Oh.